But do you know that Abraham himself was not a godly man in the beginning? He was never born a Christian. In fact, the Bible tells us he was born in the Ur of the Chaldees. He was in a family that worshipped idols. He was an idol worshipper. He was an ungodly man. But how did Abraham, this ungodly man, turn out to be one of the fathers of faith? How was he saved? How was Abraham justified? Same way, by faith and not works. Paul says in verses 1 to 3, "What shall we say then that Abraham, our father, pertaining to the flesh, hath found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God." He can't glory before God because he has no works that could stand God's holy eyes. So, Paul says, what does the Scripture say? What does the Bible say about the justification of Abraham? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Test. Where is this verse taken from? It is said in the Scripture, but where? I had to offer a bribe in the first service. Whoever is able to get this answer gets a candy. I'll take from my son and give it to you. Very good. Genesis? All right, let's turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 15. Excellent. You know, this is a beautiful passage, and we will look at it in more detail in a while. But let's first look at Genesis chapter 15. You can't not find Genesis. It's the first book of your Bible. And turn to chapter 15. And I'd like to read to you this very romantic scene. It's a very romantic scene. Abraham had just concluded a war. It's in the middle of the night, and God appeared unto Abraham. It's a touching scene. Verse 1. After these things, after the war and so on, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abraham." He's not yet called Abraham, all right? "I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward." And Abraham said, "Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus?" And Abraham said, "Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir." And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, "This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir." And he brought him forth abroad, and said, "Look, look now toward heaven, and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them." And he said unto him, "So shall thy seed be." And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Beautiful story, which we'll come to in a while. But here the Bible tells us, how was Abraham declared righteous? How was he justified? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. The word counted is an accounting term. It means to credit, to put into the account of, to deposit. How many of you here do internet banking? Can I see by a show of hands? No need to be shy. I don't know your number. Raise your hands, I won't know one. It's all right. How many do internet banking? Not a lot, strange. All right, I do internet banking, and I get nervy when I do internet banking. I mean, paying the bills is often a bit more straightforward, but when I'm told to transfer money to some individual account, I get nervous. Why? Because I'm scared that when I key in the account number, I may key one wrongly. And instead of going to someone I know and I intended it to be, I gave it to someone else. So what I do every time I do internet banking and fund transfer, I will check many times. Check here, check there, check here, check there, check until I'm really satisfied with it. But even then, I'm still very kiasu and concerned that I transfer my money to someone, some crook or someone I do not know. So what I do, I thought I'm very clever. But what I do is I'll always transfer $1. After I transfer $1, I'll give you a call. Hey, can you check whether you received that $1? And only when they say yes, then I transfer the rest of the amount over. Otherwise, very scary leh. You transfer your money to some unknown account because you keyed it in wrongly. You know, that's what it means for God to count, account, credit, put into our account His righteousness. We did not earn it. We did not deserve it. That crook, or not that crook lah, the other person who I deposit the account into, he did not earn it. I simply mistakenly gave it to him. But in the case of righteousness from God, it is freely given to us. You know, even up to today, I receive credits from people. My dad regularly credits money into my bank account. He thinks... I'm talking about Heavenly Father, lah. No. I'm also talking about my earthly father. He thinks that being a church worker, full-time staff, is like living like a mouse in a church. And so he's concerned, are you okay, are you okay? And so without words, he got my bank account number and every month just deposits, credits it into my account. I don't help him in his business. I don't really play a role at all, but he credits. In a very simple way, that reflects the way God gives us His righteousness. It's freely given to us. Paul goes on to say in verse 4, now to him that works is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. You know, if salvation is not credited to us by grace, then we are saying, God, I am saved because I worked for it. And God has to give us salvation because He is indebted to us. But God forbid. God does not owe any man salvation. Salvation is grace, not debt. Nobody earns it. You are given it. You receive it. And so Abraham, that supreme example, is the same. Though a great man eventually, he was not saved because of his inherent greatness, but because of God's grace. And verse 5 seals it, isn't it? But to him that works not, but believes on him that justifies the ungodly. What is Abraham in God's eyes? Ungodly. Because there is no man godly in God's eyes. No man who can reach his standards. That is the way God justifies. He justifies the wicked. He justifies the ungodly. You don't have to come and say, God, I'm good enough now for you. Or God, I've tried to clean up my act over all these years. Now you can save me. No, God justifies the ungodly. He credits the righteousness of His Son into your life account. Abraham was saved by faith. Justified by faith, without the deeds of the law. Now, a question I have for you, and this is going a little bit deeper, but it's helpful. Abraham's belief in God, was it a general, vague, and woolly faith, or was it a specific faith? Did Abraham simply believe that there is a God, that He's a good God, and a holy God, and a wonderful God, and an eternal God, and that is it? Abraham got saved because he believed in the existence of a good God. When we read the Bible, sometimes we can go away with such superficial conclusions, isn't it? Oh, Abraham believed God. So there are lots of people in this world that believe God. But are they really saved? Is that what faith is all about? I'm going to share with you what Scripture teaches about that. And we go back to Genesis 15. In Genesis 15, there is a very unusual phrase, and those who have been learned in Scripture would be able to pick up that special something that will be helpful in the understanding of the specificity of that faith. You look at verse 5, it says, he brought him forth abroad, out into the open, and said, look, look towards heaven, and look at all the stars, if you are able to number them at all. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. There is a phrase that is special, that is unique, that I hope you will be able to tell me. Which phrase would that be? Thinking. Today is thinking day. Actually, every Sunday, every time we come to the word, we must think. Sorry? Lord. Okay, no, not that word. The Lord here is Jehovah, Yahweh, the tetragrammaton. Another phrase, try, come. Sorry? Believe in the Lord is what we have been preaching. It's true, but there's something special. Something else special. Huh? Seed. What's so special about seed? Come on. What's so special about seed? By the way, you are right. It is the seed. But what is special about seed? Huh? Mustard seed. Wow. Very creative. No, this one has no reference to mustard seed. Mustard seed. Very good, Carol. Don't you think the English, she's English, by the way. British, so they're particular about English. But don't you think there is something wrong with the English here? Look at the stars. And then it says, twinkle, twinkle, little stars. And then God says, so shall thy seed be. Eh? Abraham, wouldn't Abraham be thinking, hey, what's wrong? He tells me to look at the stars, but he tells me my seed. Doesn't make sense. Maybe to us it doesn't make sense. But to Abraham it makes absolute sense. Can anyone tell me what is the significance of the singular form of this word seed? Because it refers to the confidence, fellas. You got it. It refers to come, I need a brave soul that'll say. It refers to the Savior or Messiah. Now, who tell you so? What is your proof? What is your basis? Can't it be that it's just poor language or English? Or who tells you that this is the promise about the Messiah? Sorry? Okay, some Genesis 3, there's that maybe you can use that. Maybe, but there's something even clearer.